his opponent in match number one is John Handegard, who after a slow start this season, averaged 227 this week. PBA Hall of Famer Gary Dickinson absolutely owned the championship round there of 41 and 42, averaging a whopping 261, while right-hander Ryan Winger will be shooting for his second consecutive senior title. Meanwhile, the top seed Jimmy Thurston will need to capture just one game in order to win his first senior title since 1990. And welcome everybody to Stanton Lanes, located in Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania. Good evening, everybody. I'm Denny Schreiner, along with PBA Hall of Famer Mike Durbin, welcoming back the senior tour on ESPN this summer. And Michael, even during your best years on the regular tour, I don't think you could have struck enough to make the show here tonight. Astronomical numbers.
Yeah, there were a lot of 300 games this week. On this pair, all five finalists averaged a whopping 238, coming into with a high of Jerry Dickinson of 261. We just hope the big stories continue tonight, though.
I'm not sure that the Energizer Bunny would have a chance against our number five qualifier. He just keeps rolling along, Mike Durbin.
Well, he won the senior Turing Pro Doubles. He has seven senior championships, more than anyone else. Three games, the fifth, sixth, and seventh games last night. He bowled 8-16 while winning only one of those three games. In 1977, at a tournament in Florida, he bowled 8-20-some, three games there, and he went on to win that tournament. Maybe it'll happen again here tonight.
Michael, throughout his career on the senior tour, John Handegard may be the most consistent player out here. He qualifies again this time, number four.
What's an interesting stat, Ben, is for three consecutive years, John Handegard has won the fourth senior tournament of the year. This is our fourth senior tournament. He has six senior titles. Peter has seven. He's got to get by him first and win four games. It'll be a tough task.
Oh, yeah, and if you win that match, then all you get to do is take on Hall of Famer Jerry Dickinson, one of the youngest seniors out here. He's looking for his first victory out here.
And that's always the toughest one, but he's a great match game player. In the second round, he won all eight games. On this pair, he averaged a whopping 261, so he says he's ready.
Earlier this past May, Ron Winger, a good friend of yours from the old days out on the tour, finally won a national tournament. He is a new man, loose and bowling very nicely.
Yeah, he won in Chicago just a few weeks ago. As you say, I used to room with Ron years and years ago. He was a great junior player. Now he's becoming a great senior player, kind of skipped in between, you know? But he's looking to try and make it two in a row tonight.
Jimmy Thurston won in 89 out here. He won in 90. It's been two and a half, almost 3 years since a victory for him. He's one of the most aggressive players out here, especially from the top spot.
Well, Jim is great in a one-game match, but he has an ability to reach down inside of himself and pull out an intensity for one game like that. Look out for Jimmy tonight. He's going to give it all he has.
All five seniors have national titles. It should be a tremendous show. We're getting ready for the start of match number one, featuring Peter Cervez and John Handegard. Peter Cervez to open things up on lane 41, and practice.
Certainly a striking there, but of course both these guys have their 13 senior titles between the two of them.
One and two right now in terms of most titles. Peter up high in the pocket and a nice break to open up the opening match.
Just that 4-7-10 out of there. In practice, he was just stuffing them all, wasn't he?
Maybe got a little slow with the
feet. Well, Kennedy on the first shot got away with it, though.
A striking bowling machine right here in John Handegard.
It's a repeating machine. So it's every shot the same as the
as a computer. That one registers, ends up with a solid 10 pin.
Interesting now, Peter came out through the first shot a little soft. John threw his a little harder, and it was a hard 10. Of the two, John's shot actually was purer and better, and he got nine.
And of course, that would be the tendency probably for both plays in pressure situations, don't you think?
I think it depends on your personality, Dan. I know under pressure, I had to make myself think to throw it harder because I would slow up. A guy like Joe Berardi would always throw it hard,
sure. They're up for the handyman in the opening frame.
John Handegard, a four-step player, holds the ball waist high. See how that right foot can touch? Backswing right here. Is that shoulder high? As he goes into the slide. Perfect balance at the foul line, perfect follow-through. That's the way you want to teach your youngster to do it right now.
Handegard with a solid game from start to finish. 224 on this parallel this week. And a nice flush hit. High pocket hit on lane 41 survived his first strike.
Yeah, Peter wants to get out quickly and get the handy guard because he knows he's gone to throw strikes and strikes and strikes.
If Peter would win tonight, he would move into second place on the current money list. Become the first two-time winner this year on the senior tour. Oh my. Clean, crisp release on that shot.
Just pretty. Steven, five step over. See how he holds the ball higher than handy guard. His backswing, as we'll see, is also much higher. And it controls the downswing. Now as the backswing gets to the height, you see it's all the way up over his head. He's in his pivot step right there, ready to take that step. He'll bend that knee. Watch the bend of the knee. It's real low to the foul line. You can't throw it much better than that one.
Trying to increase the early lead. In game number one.
Looks like he's really concentrating on going slow. That seems to be the thought pattern in his mind right now.
Another beautiful shot for Peter Chimaz here. 59 years of age, showing no sign whatsoever of slowing out.
That's amazing to me. Peter, who can repeat shot, even though he has that high backswing. See the control of the swing right there. That's not a free swing. He's controlling it. But the results are 10 pins in the pit.
After the 10 pin, John Handegard with a beautiful shot on lane 42. And you and I, neither one of us surprised that the scoring condition here in the championship round, they threw a bunch of strikes here this year.
Certainly did, and John took a re-rack on that strike. And the solid 10 in the first frame makes you see that pocket getting smaller and smaller, so he took the re-rack. And we see the speed, 18.8 miles per hour, and just a small head belly of about 2.5 4.
Trying to climb back into the map. Another beautiful shot for John Handegard. He answers with a three-bagger of his own.
And he always comes back when he does so well with that little wry smile, like a little boy just getting patted on the head, you know?
So funny, the players have an hour to practice prior to the telecast, and most players will practice parts of that hour. John Handegard shoots shot after shot for 60 minutes.
Just loves the ball.
He does love the ball, yeah. This guy loves the first time.
That's a hurry. Oh, what a nice break.
Ooh, that's a signal right there. Gave that shot a little bit of room, Michael. Got away with one on the light hit.
And we see Peter at 5'11", 180 pounds. He's been that 180 pounds since he was by 39, you know? 33 years of pro. This is a replay of the shot. If you see, a little bit softer, a little bit wider. It didn't look like it could back there. Now, what hits the 7 pin? The 4 pin fell into the 7 pin there, man. Nine for five.
The trying is over. He does have a 5-bagger. So, Peter Chimaz storms to the early lead here. In Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania. Tremendous turnout all week long by the fans.
Handegard looks thinner, but weighs 5 pounds more. Hard to believe he's 55 or 8, 25 years ago. What's that, 58 years between the two of them, playing 13 titles.
Well, it carries. Yep. Now, what's interesting about this condition, the handyman playing a very tight shot to the pocket, and Peter Chimaz obviously circling the ball a little bit.
Right. John is just trying to ride that oil line right down the pocket, but Peter's circling around it.
10 shots, 9 strikes,
and 1 solid 10 pins. Unfortunately, when you're in a match like this, you can't afford to catch it.
Interesting thing, last night, Peter Chimaz started with the first 8 against Jimmy Curtin, and guess what?
Got beat.
Mm.
That was right after he bowled 300 also.
Kind of beat, guard with the Greek church, and that popped up at a very inopportune time for John Handegard as Peter Chimaz is locked in on this set.
But sometimes that will happen when you're riding an oil line that you get just a little bit soft and the ball will knife through. What he wants to try and do is probably go for the 3 pins here and hope something flags on and knocks them all out of there. Doesn't happen.
So the handyman derails himself at the midway point. Peter Chimaz trying to cool off a little bit, but he's got the hot hand. A big lead for Peter in game number one. first-round finals of the Wyoming Valley Open are being brought to you by Midas, the Midas way, the way it should be. And by Bud Light. If you want great taste, it won't throw you up and never let you down. Make it a Bud Light. It is Canales who first captured a national title on the PDA Tour back in 1968, leads by 29, and is in control.
And then he's thinking about something else other than winning.
All we had to do is say it, huh? It's like, this guy hasn't missed a free throw yet.
Wang.
You win in that 10-10
shit.
It was like the old bowling. It was like somebody poked you right in the rib from all those years.
All those years, right.
You just start flinching when those 10-10 happen. Tita with a beautiful shot. Ending up with a solid 10. The shot is spring. The lead is maintained at this stage. And don't forget, tomorrow night, we're going to get 7:30. We've got baseball action for you. The Rangers and the Detroit Tigers.
Oh, what about the Tigers at this point?
You're probably looking for the high-level bridge at this stage.
What a tailspin, huh?
Oh, well, they've got plenty of offense. They'll turn things around. And, of course, the Yankees, who are off to an excellent start, take on the Athletics. That's the late game. Big doubleheader tomorrow night. Peterson is trying to look back into the strike column, and lane 41 provides yet another miscue.
Well, I'll tell you, that lane just, with both bowlers, just makes that little sudden snap at the back end, and both of them pay the full penalty. Handigar certainly has second life right now.
I mean, that's like 4 minutes in the penalty box when you need something like that. That'll slow you down. John Handigar thinking, well, not the break that I needed. He just stopped the spring. Now he has an open. I'm within striking distance. I've got to get myself going.
Well, he's within 14 pins with 4.5 frames to go. It can happen. Or 3.5 frames to go.
Well, he's really performed well on the senior tour in clutch situation.
Boy, was that the frozen road? That was fell back all the way.
You know, it's interesting, Mike. You mentioned something just prior to the telecast, and you can see it here with John. The height of John's back is completely different than Peter Sinek.
There has been an interesting between the two. It just shows you that bowling such a diverse game, that both guys get it done in such a proficient style, that they approach it from a different angle. I mean, that the attack is even different. John is trying to go straighter, Peter looping it.
If you've got a shorter backswing, you're going to throw the ball straight on. Should you?
He's with it. He's with it. Boy, he makes the adjustment right now. You think, did he go one and one left on that or?
Good question. We'll have to watch the next time around. I mean, you can almost parallel your game to a certain degree to the way John Handiver is playing on the team.
Very similar.
Very accurate and repeat shot after shot. Get locked in and hit the box. Peter leads by 4, but after Handigar doubled, he got his attention. Now Peter comes back with a strike of his own.
Two shots coming up right here, Ben.
All right, what's Peter do? Did he make the mistake with speed, or is he going to move?
He's going to move, Ben. Yeah. He's definitely going to move his feet left one more at least. That's my humble opinion.
That's what you would have done, right?
Absolutely. No, I'm not fooling around. Much rather be light than hot.
Right here, puts him back on top by 14, heading down the front run.
Ooh, he moves and still went higher. I'd move again.
Okay, well, what about more luck?
That's one way to approach it. It was never necessarily mine. I'd move my feet. Over close to the third out, watch the 2-10, hits the 4. And the guard has to strike it. Keep it within 4 pins if he can strike. Willie Perry. No.
You knew it when it left.
I didn't know it. Just in situations like that, you're fighting to get back up. I've seen it happen in many, many sports. You know, you get so close. That would have set him up to take the lead with the next shot. And the 10-10 has a way of standing. Cross lane at the 10th, and he's not lost. He wants it. The 6-10 just wrapped right around that 10th. Very straight at the fair. It's a great thing. He's not out of the match, but he has to strike here and set himself up for the 10th. Down 15-10.
Speaking of setting himself up, last night won 7 of 8 matches in a very close final 8 games here just to qualify for the telecom.
He's bold enough to give you one errant shot. You know, he gets 5 and 8 out on that one.
And he trails, but when the scores are high, that's normally the case.
Yep. Okay. Boy, we're long.
But it carries. See, I'm thinking that basically, I don't think it's so much a move there. I think it's just a touch of delay. I think if you move a little too far left, that ball's going to skip. I'd like to be able to see 260 and leave.
Well, it should be 230 if he goes out.
Oh, that's the cat. Okay. We have different courses this week.
Yes. We're getting a little different to us, right? Kind of fake both of us out there, Daddy.
Give them a home version, draw up your own. Okay, I wouldn't want to lose with 230 either, to be quite honest with you.
He's got Peter's attention for that 10th frame, I'll tell you. He's going to need to fill. There's one more strike. If he's at 230 even, Peter will have to fill 16 pins in the 10th frame.
And if you're out here, that's what you want. You want to make your opponent fill with something.
Nine strikes. And he probably doesn't have a chance, huh?
One errant shot, as you mentioned, in the sixth when he was on a four-bagger. It was a good shirt. And that was all she wrote for John. Now it's a question of what Peter does during the tenth.
Strike box it up. A lot of room. But it roared back. Beautiful.
I think Peter realizes, especially on 42, Mike, that he does have a little room to play with to the right.
And the ball seems to make an even arc back there. It doesn't make that overreaction and snap through the nose.
Like it has done on occasion on the left hand.
On the left hand, right.
Peter Kamara is the winner in match number one. We'll get it easier. Gary Dickinson, the next player on the step ladder. Hey, Peter is one of the prettiest bowlers to watch when he's in stroke and that ball comes off his hand. It's one of the cleanest releases that you'll find, not only on the senior tour, but on the regular tour.
Well, especially tonight. You know, we were watching that in practice and watching how the hand action that he had going forward. And what we're talking about that for the novice bowler is when that thumb comes out and those fingers just rotate around the ball and impart force to that ball, he is really just putting on a classic demonstration in this first game. Of course, he's getting some breaks for a strip forward.
Yeah. He's got the right roll, the right cover, the right angle, and the right speed. A big game for Peter, 255 to 230 over John Handegard. And when we come back, a look at Mike Durbin's average builder. For our last average builder, we talked about getting back to the basic fundamentals of the sport of bowling. And that time, specifically, we talked about how to put our hand in the bowling ball. Well, continuing on with that theme of back to the basic fundamentals, tonight we're going to talk about the stance. And specifically, where do I stand and how do I stand? And the stance we're going to be talking about is in relation to a four-step delivery. You can see that I'm out here by the foul line. What I'm going to do right now is take 4.5 brisk steps right toward the end of the approach, and that will give me where I should stand to start with. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4.5. Right here, and that's where I need to start my stance from. That gives me my starting position. Now the question is, how do I stand? Well, really, there are no absolute guidelines on this or absolute rules, because there's as many different stances as there are bowlers in the sport of bowling. But there are some guidelines that I can give you that will help you to have a better, more comfortable, proper stance. And speaking of the word comfortable, that's the first guideline. However I stand here, I want to be comfortable. I want to be relaxed so that I can bowl better. I'm not going to bowl better if I'm tense. The second thing is that I like to have the feet together like so. You may want to put your left foot slightly in front of your right, whatever is comfortable to you. But the important thing is put most of the weight on the left foot. The reason for this is that enables me to start with the right foot easier. Next, let's have the knees slightly flexed, slightly bent. This is kind of an athletic position, and again, it helps to relax me. Next, the shoulders should be square and straight, I think, back, not bent over like this, with the chin level. And last, we want to take the bowling ball and hold it so it's in line with my right shoulder. Now, I may want to hold it at waist high, I may want to hold it higher, wherever, just make sure it's in line with the right shoulder, so when I swing it, it'll get by my hip easier. So remember, where do we stand? 4.5 steps from the foul line. How? We want to be comfortable, the feet together, most of the weight on the left foot with the knees flexed, the chin level, and the ball in line with the right shoulder. If you do that, you not only have a comfortable stance, but a proper one. We'll see you again next week from Montreal, Canada, where we'll have another average shoulder.
Plenty of strikes in the opening game. Junior Semez prevails with a 255-230 victory over John Handegard, who ended up fifth. And let's now assess the rest of the top 24. West strikes missed by just 7 pins. John Hersinner with 7.
Former senior player of the year, Don Johnson, Hall of Famer, and Bill Burney from Ohio.
Couple of Midwestern PBA Hall of Famers, Tucson Weber in the middle of the set.
And Billy Dom from Akron along with Larry Phillips.
Elsewhere down the top 24, Jack Horner was 14th and Jim Long was 15th.
And Tommy Evans still bowling well, another Ohioan and Al Sanford.
Frankie May, who had a big Masters this year, was 18th, and Jimmy Brenner, 19th.
And of course, Bob Hart, I get all the ones from Ohio, don't they? Along with the slim down Robert Gibbs.
Dave Deacon, 22nd, and Bill Gould was 23rd.
And of course, John Petrucci, and the alternate was Ernie Belt, who actually had to drop out.
All right, when we come back, Peter Chimay, Gary Dickinson will do it up in game number 2. Peter Chimay, looking for his second victory this evening, will face Hall of Famer Gary Dickinson.
He struggled in his practice ball, too.
Very straight, much the same as John Handegard, maybe even straighter than the Handegard.
One more speed.
Peter opened with the first 5 in game number 1, and he is still living life on the edge, tripping out at 4 p.m.
That's 3 or 4 times he's tripped out the 4. The 4 and the 9 went out late that time. Nice young man there. Oh, that's Peter's son.
Oh, good. Yeah, I think that's Michael.
Well, he's braver than that. What's going on? 8, 7, and 4. Three kids, isn't that?
Michael's your name? Marissa and Derek. And Sam, his wife is here. Oh, Gary Dickinson says, got away with a wall shot there. That was a fall-away jumper.
Well, he left the bucket the last shot in practice. So that's a little bit higher anyway. The one hit the two at least on that shot.
Our good buddy Richard Altman, back in Edmond, Oklahoma, the sponsor of Gary Dickinson and the owner of Boulevard Bowl, I'm sure watching anxiously here this evening. Gary averaged 244 yesterday for the final 8 games, for the final 16 games of match play.
There is good stroke there.
About 700 over in the last 16 games. And open with a double. And speaking of siblings, Daniel on hand this summer to travel with Dad, and the last time I saw Daniel, he was probably about 4 feet tall. He's going 1.5 feet or something. He's only 13.
I'm wondering, I mean, these guys, Peter's 7 years older than I am. Gary's 1 year younger or something like that. They got kids 7 years younger than mine.
Yeah. Traveling with their parents this summer. Great experience for the kids. That is not through the nose. It's the first mistake we've seen on the right-hand lane for Peter tonight.
Right, he's had that good reaction. Again, that seemed softer at that particular time, Ben. Watch it. A little after the third arrow, the ball makes a move too quickly, right there. That's what he hasn't been able to do before, or hasn't done. He's going to go hard. Actually, no, he's just going for 2. He didn't even go hard at the 4-7. He just went for the 2.
One of the differences between the seniors and the touring players sometimes will rear up and throw a 23-mile-an-hour third shot and jump some pins out.
Well, the seniors would do that, too.
Some of them.
Percenter would definitely be the
biggest
shot at it.
But most of them don't.
Save us for another day.
So many 4.6s in there, too. It made so few.
Yeah. I want to throw your shoulder out either on a four shot. Look at that reaction now. These lanes changed that dramatically, or has Kuda all of a sudden lost the stroke?
Well, I think it's a combination of both then. Right? Now, the lanes have definitely changed. I mean, he went high and took the four out, and then high again, and then high again. He's got to make more of an adjustment toward the center of the lane, but make sure that his speed is firm. Trouble. Ooh, came back and got it. All right.
Good job for Kuda. And among the celebrities on hand, the Grump. Of course, the Grump is the mascot for the Red Baron, the Wilkes-Barre Red Baron. They just happen to be Philadelphia's AAA Farm Club. They're in first place in their division and playing some great baseball. A sellout crowd here the other night for their ball game. Fans around here love their minor league baseball, almost like Buffalo. Great support.
You know, it's interesting. In between games, Peter went over and sat down on the lap of the Grump. As we watched Ray Dickinson with his five-step approach to the ball held reasonably high. Controlled swing all the way through. As he reaches the peak right here, right in line with the hook. There's his leg ready to bend the knee at that point. Nice long slide. Very smooth release. Been doing that the same as long as I've known it.
I was going to say, you could probably take some old film. That's what it would do, black and white. Put the pencil to Gary Dickinson, and there would be very little change in his game.
To finish my point, though, Peter went over between games and sat down in the lap of the Grump, you know, was sitting around with the Grump. I'm just wondering if that affected his concentration a little bit. You know, sometimes it's hard to turn it on and turn it off, you know, like a faucet.
Playing to the crowd, playing to the Grump. Yeah, maybe he's looking for free tickets to the ball game tomorrow.
No, I don't think so. I think he's looking to win this next match, but he's got a chance for it. He's looking for 6-4. Everybody's in 180.
Well, why are you upset about that?
I'm not in the 180s. Oh, that's right.
The highest end of that.
Yeah, highest.
He's trying to shake off a couple of bad shots. And he does with a beautiful strike on lane 42.
And you see that was a little deeper? He made the move, and he's going to have to make another move over here on the left wing.
Interesting you mentioned that, because Jimmy Curtin played inside, deep inside, throughout the entire tournament. He led four rounds, ended up leading the tournament. That was the place to be if you were going to strike this week.
Well, Jimmy told me that came out today, they were like 7-8 works tighter than they had been all week. So they're kind of breaking down as the players are playing on them right now.
Within 21.
Wow, that takes a flat move again, and he got that four pin again.
He would take a quick look at the approach. All right, he's made the adjustment mentally. He must do something on that left hand.
Well, he probably moved. He's wondering, I got to go another ball for him. I'm afraid to go. I don't want to be late,
but he's going to be standing in the audience here in 5 or 10 minutes. You shut it down early with a perfect shot, left a solid eight, and all you can do is shake your head and go back and keep it.
And you watch that. It's amazing. If that happens on a ball going that straight into the pins, you see that shot right there, and didn't get to see in the slow motion, so it's hard to tell exactly what happened. If you convert the eight pin, but what I always thought is that the Hatchman hits the team. Go ahead, do your promo.
All right, the Pepsi 400 is a 4th of July tradition, which marks the midway point of the NASCAR Winston Cup Series. 160 times around that 2.5-mile track. 400 tough, grueling miles on ESPN coming up on Saturday.
I always said when I watch those guys, they've got at least 10 and 4.
You find 10 pins?
Yeah. Well, 4 and 8 and 10. Anyway, to finish my thought on the call, is that the headpin hits the 2, the butt of the headpin hits the 5 before the ball gets there, so when the ball's going through there, there's nothing for it to hit, it's already moved.
I think you should get something for Solomon.
You do, you get 9 pins.
Well, I'm going to need more than that. Something. I'm going to start politicking for that. I'm starting right now here this evening. Maybe get a patch or something. I don't know. We'll be back with more. Hopefully no more Eastern than Rookstar. And welcome back to the finals of the Wyoming Valley Open at Canton Lanes, located in Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania. Danny Schreiner and Mike Irvin alongside, watching Peter Cimek here in game number two, the opening stop of the PBA Summer Tour, on ESPN, playing the seniors event, touring professionals event. They come your way. Oh, boy, there's a difference. Peter with more power knocks out both the 7 and the 10. Dickinson left that week 10. Now it's under 10 pins, and it's right here, and he can take the lead. Watch the interesting pin reaction here. The 7 and 10 will be up there for a split second. We're hoping if it comes in late. Well, it looks like the 5, the 8, the 7, and the 10 were all there for a second. Watch it. There's the 5. Now the 8 went pretty quick, but the 7, 5 went over and got the 7, and 6 got the 10.
In unison falling, the 7 and the 10, Tito with a smile, a three bagger, and right here, back to the lead. What a turnaround.
That's why he's won 7 senior titles at age 59.
Now let's see how Gary Dickinson responds to the heat here in Rochdale.
Better than I did here the last time, solid in.
Dickinson has done nothing but hit the pocket. Game number two. Two strikes. 3-9 count. A little more room on this guy. He paid for it.
Wow, that's the overreaction at that point in time. See, I never thought that might be going through his mind. If the condition is slightly different today, he had a 261 on this day using another ball. Now he comes out here and says, oh, boy, I can kill this there, but he has to change balls. It's not quite the same shot.
Condition, no matter how they try and put it down, changes from day to day, especially on the national tour.
Certainly does. And we've seen speed lower. See, he swung it and hit the drive, and when it's hooking, it goes slower. Swung it out, well, really not a whole lot. And here's where you see the difference in speed, almost a mile per hour, and a little bit deeper with the set down. Perfect there.
Got to keep it in that oil to see the head area then. Good job on the left-hand lane, so Peter Cimek with a 3-10 lead, looking to extend there. Ron Winger warming up right now. He is number 2 seed of Jimmy Curtin, the top performer this week. He'll bowl for the title in about a half an hour. For his fifth consecutive strike. Oh, he's come hard to that.
Well, see, all the great pros have the ability that once they get lined in, they can take it out the seat. And that's what Peter is doing at this point in time. 13 pins, though, if he doesn't strike here, Dickinson can get right back.
Well, Dickinson has already mathematically figured his 245 if he can strike out.
Right. See, in fact, if he doesn't strike here, Dickinson can strike out and lock it up.
Well, he really has moved deep on that left-hand lane.
Well, it's like knowing how to read in the green, the band or something like that. He knows how to make those adjustments and get that ball solid in the 1-3 pocket.
Well, there's no question that the players that make the best adjustments on the national tour are the ones that are going to be most successful if you're throwing quality shots along with it.
And right now, the most important shot of the week is coming up today. But it's got to strike here at Canada. Down 22.
Inside. Ooh! Held pocket nice. A completely different shot than the last time on lane
3. Right, where it swung and bit real quick. That one held the oil all the way down the line. If the bowler track were on that one, it would show that the speed was at least a mile per hour greater. 13 pins. This one cuts it to 3. The speed on that last one was 18.6. So it's a 1.1. 17.5 there in the 7 foot.
Mm-hmm.
Got to have this one there. Very smooth. Ooh, somebody else took the 4 and the 9 out of there.
Peter. Not even a flinch. Peter's probably already at this point in time setting himself up mentally for Dickinson striking out, telling himself what he's going to have to do to win the match.
Absolutely. And again, I thought this was just almost too smooth a stroke. The ball bites, goes high, the two comes to the board, and the four and the nine are down. It'll be interesting to see if he's thinking in his mind a little more speed on this shot. 17.9. He's bending that speed the mile per hour. Just by how much he swings the ball.
This one to apply the pressure.
Oh,
Terry himself right there. So Terry Dickinson using the entire pocket here in the 10th frame to give Peter the wake-up call.
And watch this for how quick it goes down off his hand. The one before went at least 12 inches further out of the lane. This one kind of fell off his hand, but rolled all the way. The accuracy was there. He thinks he's got a chance. Right away, he's moving.
One more for a beautiful game of 245. And so Gary Dickinson finishes with five straight, Mike Durbin, to give Peter Sommer something to think about.
Oh, absolutely. Peter must strike this first ball in the 10th. With eight and a spare to win the match. Got it.
Funny room. And just a little too much. So Gary Dickinson digging in. And finishing strong with her five-bagger will advance into the semifinal game.
You know, Tina has been trying the whole game to go with a different push away, without pushing it out to have it go down, a la Pete Weber.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes under pressure, when you're making a change like that in your game, it's difficult to do it with all the chips on the table.
He came over and mentioned that to us after the opening game, where he threw the beautiful game of 255, and although he ends up shooting the game in the 230s, it wasn't quite enough to get the job handled here in game number two.
And the important thing in his mind is the opportunity was there, and he didn't take advantage of it.
Yeah, because every pro wants to be able to go up and dictate what's going to happen in the 10th frame, especially when you have a good condition, a good shot like Peter did here in the season. So for Peter Sommer, the fourth place finish, Gary Dickinson will advance to take on Ryan Winger. But when we come back, our Mike Durbin will get a chance to chat with the Orange Wonder, Jimmy Thurton, our top seed this week in Wilkes-Barre. The Merry Mets, Lee Trevino, along with Kiki Rodriguez, Jerry Blair, Rocky Thompson, Larry Loretti, just to name a few that will be performing at the Jack Nicklaus Sports Center this coming weekend down in Cincinnati, Ohio, covering Friday through Sunday, the Cadillac Senior PGA Tour on ESPN. Diddy Gilbert will also be back. He captured the event last year. So a host of the top professionals on the PGA Senior Tour down in the Queen City this coming weekend. And of course, let's take a look now at the recap of match number two. Gary Dickinson coming back with a beautiful five-bagger to finish off Peter Sommer, 245-236. And a guy who threw a lot of strikes this week is standing by with Mike Durbin, Jimmy Thurton.
Thank you, Danny. As mentioned, with me is a tournament leader this week. Jimmy said, well, Jimmy, I got to ask first of all here, you know, this outfit, I haven't seen you in before. Is this a Halloween outfit, or are you came short here?
This is a lady in Huntsville may be familiar, and they're custom fit. Don't they look good?
They look great. Why don't you wear them during the week?
Well, I can save them for 2 years. Okay.
Jimmy, let's talk a little bit about your career. 1989, Senior Player of the Year. You're cruising along. You win another tournament and everything. Then a knee injury happens, or some kind of injury, and the last couple of years have been a struggle. Tell us about that injury.
I hurt an old Fallon at the doubles, and I don't know how I hurt it. I think I was carrying too many balls upstairs too many times or something. Anyway, it started swelling up on me, and it hurt my, you know, all the rest of 92. I had a real problem with it. And then I went to a sports clinic in Birmingham and gave me some exercises there. And I did them for a little while. It got better, but then I still kept trying to practice, and then practice, it would swell up, so I had to lay off about 2 months.
Okay, you were over there practicing. Dickinson seems pretty well lined in. You got a game plan. You've had a great week all week. What's going to happen this final game?
I'm just going to try to get out and get, Mike. It don't matter who I bowl. If I bowl a good game, I got a pop to win it.
You think you lined in on that thing?
I'm pretty close. We're getting a little better after everybody bowls, so I'll find out after the next pitch.
Okay. Sounds like there's a little hesitation there, but Jimmy will be ready. In our next match, we're going to see if Ron Winger can continue on the road to two in a row, but in his way, as Hall of Famer, Jerry Dickinson.
Welcome back to Kent Lane, located in Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania. Here in the semifinal match, Jerry Dickinson edging Peter Cernay.
With a variety of strikes.
Used them all. Probably going to leave him again against Ron Winger. But a loose arm swing and an aggressive chop to open up game number three.
So it's easy once you get that game on your belt, you know. Especially with Jerry. His goal is not to win when he wants to win the first.
But you have to win the first one to get there.
Ronnie with six steps. Comes up there.
And ends up with a light hit strike, and you can almost see the relief on his face after winning for the first time in 30 years off and on the national team.
Oh, hey, it's a long time. Hit steps, see the knees bent at the beginning, ball right about the shoulder high, moves that right foot, now he pushes it, hits the backswing right here, and we see the knee bent, he's in position in that pivot step, as he goes through. A little erect at the line on that pitcher's shot.
I don't know why, but the knee bend from start to finish there almost reminiscent of Johnny Gunter's game. Or am I reaching there?
No, Johnny, similar with five steps, you know, kind of chugged up there the same type of way.
Great performer for many years on the PBA Nationals. We're talking about a guy that could throw strikes in the clutch. A wonderful game. Dickinson with a high, hard one. Could he trip out the four?
Gunter always used to win the major sportsmanship award. Our friend here, Mr. Dickinson, has won on several occasions, too. They just were easygoing guys that didn't seem to let the prevails of the game bother them.
Took the good with the bad.
Yeah.
Tried to maintain a level approach.
And did.
And very successfully.
Yeah. More room, Vaughn's getting nice on that left lane. Now he goes to wide and is coming back to the pocket.
He has figured it out. At least the left-hand lane, that is. Ron Winger working on a double. Ahead by 10.
He likes that, but see if he hedges right. To get it flush.
Did you run?
No, I don't. He just threw a little better is what he did.
Yep. I had a chance to talk to Ronnie earlier, prior to the telecast, and ask him about the possibility of winning two in a row.
Well, Danny, I really do think I have a real big shot here. I'm really nice and loose. After winning that first one, I mean, I feel like I can't do anything wrong. And I had a real good week here. I had my final eight games was really strong, and I'm really confident. I feel good. I think I can do it. I really do.
So is it whistling in the graveyard, or does he believe it?
I didn't believe it.
Yeah, I did, too.
Starting in the first three. That's a statement. Confident player though. He's got some room and he knows it. And you can see the difference in his approach and his attitude after winning. The pressure is off. He's out there enjoying himself. How many times have you seen a player win and come right back and win again?
Well, it's that confidence, that intangible, that inner belief in yourself that you can do it. There's always the question mark before then.
Question marks now that remain. So Dan looks on. Does Dan have enough to get by Mr. Winger?
Oh, the game is early yet. There are a lot of ways to go yet.
Jerry Dickinson was trailing heading into the eighth and ninth frames against Peter Cernay and pulled off a nice win.
See, the difference, though, here is if Jerry knows he can win, it's just a matter now of doing it on the senior tour. It's been a long time since he's won a tournament.
Double coming back to answer Winger. Gary had an opportunity to win the Senior Touring Pro Double. He was the top seed in that event in O'Fallon, and they were defeated by Peter Samaras and Richard Reed.
A very exciting match.
Oh. There's some counsel there, didn't he?
Yeah.
What did he do?
That's terrific, Joe.
Winger flips it out, rolls it up, but again, nice compact game.
Well, we finally got somebody out of the honey maybe.
Yeah. Well, I probably can test that when we talk to him later.
Years a pro, 32. And see, the trouble is, I remember him when he was a teenager.
The good news is, at least you remember.
Right.
He's going to claim that he weighs less than 190 now because he's always let it off at least a couple of pounds.
Right, exactly. Of course.
Under 190. And the fighter is a little heavy, and by the time he's done. All he's doing right now is throwing solid right hands as he is halfway home here in game number three.
Well, I'd like to see what hit the tent on that shot. Okay,
yeah. When we come back, we'll take a look. Ron Winger doing nothing but striking here in the Wilkes-Barre. When we come back, will Gary Dickinson be able to match? Dickinson down by 30 and not bowling too badly.
Well, he just got a couple more strikes right here.
Needs to strike to keep pace, and that's not going to get the job done. 3-6 is left on lane 42.
Same mistake he made in the second frame, the last one. Just got it wide too quick. Can't do that. You've got to start the ball in the arm. And concentrating on this fair.
Ooh. Wow. Took the three off the six. Not what he was hoping for. And Ron Winger with a golden opportunity to waltz into the title match.
Chop that three right off the six.
Now looking to get back in the strike column on lane 41. Stop looking, Jerry. All he can do is turn around, look at the floor, and say, yeah, right. Now I got a solid eight on each leg.
At least it went back to back, he says. But,
Well, happens every time. Just when you think it can't get any worse, it does.
Well, he overcame it last game, but this guy's got them all right now, Eddie.
He's halfway, and we're in the seventh frame now for Ron Winger. Remember, Ron, he's a great senior boy.
Oh, Southern California, he's up there.
Been knocking him down for a lot of years.
Right there, boy, I'll tell you what. The thoughts start turning toward a possible 300 then.
We had one here on ESPN. Good stuff.
Yes, interesting, all the tournaments we covered, you know, with the national coach and so with a senior that had it. Of course, we had the great Mark Ross at 299 at Buffalo that one year.
Up to 10, didn't it?
Yeah, would say. A little extra time here now for running. Thinking about it.
Momentarily, but Ryan's about. I had so much fingers, no way.
And watch the replay as the 5-7 is up there a long, long time. Comes in light, head thing goes through sideboards, and the 5 and 7 fall opposite directions. And
guess what? The 4 was there with him. Gary Dickinson just trying to get out of the way. Okay.
Same type of hit. Dickinson, he's 236 and not even be close at this point in time. Gary in the ninth frame. As Denny said, just trying to get out of the way.
You've been in that situation.
Yeah, unfortunately, yes.
Was that when Beyond the Lillo shot you?
No, no, I bowled in the next game.
Oh!
He did that against Fisher.
Oh, Les was the one who took the beating, huh?
Yeah. No, I never had anybody shoot 300 at me on TV.
Well, never did, but...
Nice thing to survive.
Just tell when he let it go, he was hoping that maybe he could get away with one more shot, but it doesn't make any difference right now to Ron Winger. He doesn't get the 300 game, but he solidifies himself for the title match.
And he gets his focus on something different right now, winning the tournament. Quick follow through. The ball goes a little too long and not enough finish.
A fair up for Ron Winger. Jimmy Sutton must be paying attention at this point in time to what Winger has accomplished.
But he knows who he's going to bowl, and Jimmy's not afraid. He's been bowling the greatest bowlers in the world for 25 years, so he's not afraid.
His only bowling goal each and every time he bowls is to beat Earl Anthony and Dick Webber.
Well, he's not going to beat Earl anymore.
He didn't get as many shots as Earl was playing, but that was his goal. I mean, I like that.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, I'm going after the numero uno, right? I'm going after the big fellas. If I beat them, I'm going to win the tournament. I think the thing, those of us who know Jimmy personally, and of course those fans who have watched him TV, is the one thing that you like about Jimmy Sutton is he's an aggressive player. And he's not going to leave any of it home. When he comes out there, it's going to go.
That's for sure.
Right? And he's got the heavy lumber out.
He's going to need it. Right now, Winger's carrying everything.
Ron Winger throwing plenty of right hand. Finished up here in the semi-final match and disposed of Gary Dickinson, perhaps a 279 for Randy Winger. Got 8 frames and left the time.
One little tension.
Terrific game for Ron Winger. He started with the first 8, finished with the last 3, and shot 279 here in the semi-final game. And, of course, as soon as we're done here in Wilkes-Barre this evening, we'll send you to Las Vegas, Nevada for ESPN Top Rank Boxing. A couple of super lightweights, Roger Mayweather and Carl Griffith. Should be an outstanding fight, but stay tuned as soon as we're done here for Top Rank Boxing. We'll be back with the title match. Ron Winger, Jimmy Sutton, the top seed. Who will win? Come on back and find out. Brought to you by Midas, the Midas way, the way it should be. And the way it should be is the way it was for Peter Simmons in game number 1, coming up in the 10th frame.
And on the right lane, playing defense side the entire game. Ball making the move at the back end, needed this mark to beat Handy Guard. That's the best kind of mark you can get.
Strike for Peter, finished out beautifully with 5 in a row in the opening game. And then it was on to match number 2, and it was Gary Dickinson in the 11th frame.
Trailing the whole game. If he strikes here, he takes the lead. Watch how early the ball goes down. Gives a long way, makes a little move at the back end, and a little old wall shot, a baby walnut.
He was hoping, and it was there. 245, 236, a come from behind win against Peter Simmons. Off to the semifinal game, Ronnie Winger with 8 in a row. Would it be a 300 here this evening?
Well, Ronnie was definitely thinking about it here, and he squeezed that fan a little bit on this shot. A little control. Ball doesn't quite finish. It's hard to keep right. And the result, the weak tension.
Winger tried to body English to 10 pin down. It wouldn't happen. A fabulous game of 279. When we come back to Huntsville, Alabama against Tarzana, California, Jimmy Sutton the top seed and Ron Winger bowling for the title here in Wilkes-Barre. The man in orange finishing up his top shot. Camera might have been out of focus, but Jimmy was.
Well, I tell you what, it was funny, Dan. I had my glasses on and my reading glasses. I took them off, and it was so funny. I thought that I still had my glasses on.
Ron Winger, you see on the alternate pair, he is warming up. The Canadian Senior Open as the seniors head up north, crossing the border into the country of Canada, Montreal. Quebec is where the seniors will be performing in the Canadian Senior Open. All the action coming your way next Thursday night, live at 7:30 Eastern Time.
Yeah, we were there last year on Canadian television, this year ESPN.
Did you see French?
No.
Okay. You said we, I was really going to be surprised. Okay, we're ready for the start of our championship match. Jimmy Sutton looks like a huge orange right now.
Well, I thought a pumpkin, but...
Oh! All right. I'm glad you said it and I didn't. All those fans in Huntsville are going to be after you.
Yes, I know. I feel like that.
I think it looks pretty sporty, I think.
It is definitely different. I like it.
Jimmy trying to come out striking. Ooh, a good solid count and a solid 10. He was all on lane 41.
Jimmy inside, riding the oil with a lot of speed, a little bit of a fan shot. That's his description of it on the side of the ball a little bit, but not a whole lot of super lift, but strong enough.
Played him in all week long.
That's his ball.
Ooh. And Brittany made the trip. She'll be out for a couple of weeks, I'm told, on the summer tour. Watching Dan perform.
Yeah.
Remember the days of Michael Jr. and Chrissy and Matthew?
Oh, I remember. Very well.
Debbie does too. From parting with a few kids all over the country. Ron Ringer says, I think I'll just start the way I did last year. Smooth 8-bag and see what happens.
See what happens. Right? Let me try to beat that.
Hit my kid. He is so funny. I mean, just, the weight of the world has been lifted off his shoulders since he won out here.
Well, I tell you, you know, when you come up in an area like Southern California, and you're Southern California Junior Bowler of the Year, you see the 18.3 miles per hour and just about a 6-board head belly flame, great things are projected for you. You know, this is going to be the next Dick Weber or whatever, and then he doesn't win. Now he does win. It's just, you know, 30 years later.
Revving it up, dicing him up on lane 41 for a double for Winger, and he, at this point in time, is not practicing.
This is a key. Need any more practice,
no,
right?
No. This one's a gamer here, though. This is a certain chance of time. He'll throw the pass.
We came to my room from Alabama. He had those stunning crimson.
Yeah. And that's the next shot. Yeah, stood up funny on that shot. Got the ball into the oil.
Flip a little bit of it.
Yeah. Ends up with a 10-10 again.
Jimmy Sutton with a 5-step approach. See the ball held right about shoulder high, feet together, knees bent. Now he pushes it. Very smooth here. And we see the backswing. Shoulder high. Ready to bench the knees.
Two 10-10, two spares. Oh, Jimmy Sutton, a likable pro from down south, 54 years of age, as you mentioned. 1989, his first year out here, and he won easily.
5-9, 200.
Two senior titles, one national event.
Well, the two heaviest guys are bowling for the title this week. Does that say something?
Two players with the most strength. Now, there was a typical Jimmy Sutton shot. Did you see how long that ball hung on his fingers, Mike Durden?
Right.
I mean, you and I would have popped those out of socket.
No, well, I don't know about that.
Well, maybe me. Ultra nuclear fingers.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that's what my reputation was, yeah. Butter reputation.
Right now, Ron Winger in the zone.
Wants to keep it going, though. It can go away as quick as it can. Pretty smooth there. Pretty smooth there.
This is fun.
Yeah.
I had so much fun doing it the last time. I think I'll do that again. Beat Mike Smarja over there in Illinois this past May.
Mike's tough bowler.
Won 3 matches to get the win.
Well, tonight, nobody's been able to win 2 in a row. Ronnie's trying to be the first. 2 games in a row, 2 tournaments in a row.
He's in a rut.
He likes that kind of rut, though.
Is it 4 in a row?
Oh, boy, he is just bowling with so much confidence right now.
Just a bump on the hand from Jimmy Curtin, something you surely wouldn't see on the national field.
Oh, I don't know. He's doing the King of the Hill all the time.
Yeah, well, I tell you what, I worked out there 4 years, been doing the show seven more, I've never seen it. Not in the title match.
Well, I'll tell you what, the bump on the hand and everything, but he better strike right now to stay in this match. Mm-hmm.
Basically, you throw hard at the four and the seven, hope something bounces out to come around to get the ten. Maybe comes out of the pit one way, he will throw hard at it.
Little zip on this shot, tried to double hit the four. Brittany not too pleased with that last result, but she knows that to come back somehow, some way. He's down by 43 though early on.
Oh boy, I mean, it's the point now where if you can do it with a pencil, you can do it with a bowling ball, but Jimmy's got to start striking. Of course, when it doesn't stop that, he won't do him any good.
Mm. A lot of reach. A strike for Jimmy certainly trying to piece something, anything together right now to give himself a semblance of hope here in the title game.
Well, one guy's fishing, the other guy found the line.
Yeah, he's already hooked the bass.
Yeah.
He's got him in the boat.
He is just wired. Absolutely wired.
Started with the first eight last game.
But he had 11 out of 12.
16 of 14.
Oh, he had 11 out of 12 the last game.
16 of 7,
right?
16 strikes out of
17 opportunities. One little tension.
The way you want to win.
Well, you want to win anyway, you can, but this is certain amount of pizzazz.
You're wider. Back flush. He's got the whole lane. That's how it feels to him, I thought.
Right.
And the interesting thing is, Mike, as we watch the other four participants tonight, it appears that one would have one lane locked up, and they'd fluctuate in another lane. He seems to have the same shot on both lanes.
Right. A little more turn for him, and see that reaction. I think when he throws it wide, he goes to the pocket.
He has to go to the pocket.
Yeah, he does. Yeah.
See what I mean?
But then Jimmy better roll one out right now in the pocket.
For a while, yeah. Trying to delay it. Beautiful shot by Jimmy. Certainly had a chance to chat with our top seed just before the telecast and ask him about that drought since the last time that he had won.
I bowled really good in 91 and had a couple of seconds, and then in 92, at O'Fallon, I hurt my knee, and I kind of struggled for the rest of the year, and early part of this year, I started bowling good again. And now I feel like I'm bowling good as I ever have, and I got to pop to win this thing.
You got to keep popping the strikes, you want to continue that pop to win, and it's still may not be enough.
See what I mean? No quit in this man. He just came charging back, but he's probably going to run out of frames unless Ryan Winger makes a serious mistake.
Yeah. Comes in light, half pocket, slaps that 10-10 out of there, indicating a good roll. Well, you see he hasn't given up. Look at that determined look on his face.
Seven in a row, starting with eight in the semifinal game.
Well, you called it. He said, take a smooth eight bagger and see what happens.
What?
The fish comes halfway up on the 10. I don't know how far it has to lean before it falls.
What
the degree of angle is, but whatever it was, that was right on the borderline.
Oh, when you get it rolling, when you match the ball to the lane, what a feeling that is.
Oh, everything's carrying now, my goodness. Eight in a row, twice in a row.
Jimmy, if he takes it out to shoot the best, he gets to 47. He would have to open twice for Jimmy to win that. Jimmy has to strike out, he has to open twice.
47 in the final match and get railroaded.
Yep. Well,
it's a bit unnerving.
Yeah, doing nothing but striking out here.
Yeah. There's a glimpse of hope when a guy is striking. If you know you have to be perfect for every shot. Ron Winger trying to accomplish something that Ron Handegard was the last to do on the senior tour, win back-to-back tournament.
And he's basically done it. He's just got to show up to the ninth and 10th frame. Now the suspense is, will he bowl 300? Will the ninth frame standing in again?
And at this point in time, becomes the first multiple winner in 1993 on the senior tour.
Mm-hmm. Only had four tournaments. He's won two of them.
Off to a good start. Jimmy Curtin with a nice round of applause from the faithful, but not going to be enough here this evening.
Well, we were in this position before. Ronnie Winger left the 10 pin in the ninth frame. And here we are now. Not a replay. And he's hoping it isn't the same replay as last year.
Mm. He likes it.
Wow. A little more confident this game, I'll tell you.
He stood there and watched it. No way on a net shot out.
But he knew it wasn't going to be the weak pin. He thought maybe he'd do the solid pin. But he's playing to the crowd. I've never seen Ron do this before. He's really into this and having a great time.
And perhaps the stardom that was predicted so many years ago will blossom on the senior tour.
Yeah, that's a marvelous thing about the senior tour. To give these guys, like, second chance.
Rebirth.
Yeah.
When you strike it like that.